The Go Radio Football Show with Global Eco Energy. Free quotes for solar PV, battery storage and heat pumps. Let's go! The Go Radio Football Show with Global Eco Energy. Contact the team now to help make your home more energy efficient.
Let's go! 2 hours to go to... Not that we're desperate for it to come back, but it seems a long time, Andy, doesn't it, since... Well... Aberdeen Rangers is the match of the weekend, but it seems a while ago since all the teams were in action in the Premiership.
Yeah, just so looking forward to getting the Scottish Premiership back. It's been a long 2 weeks. It always is on an international break. Glad that Scotland are now, you know, qualified for the Euros. We can concentrate for the next few months on our domestic football.
Two of your old teams kick it off at 3 o'clock on Saturday, Celtic and Motherwell. Should be a good game. There'll be 60,000 there. Motherwell, of course, it's been a terrible run for them, and Celtic looking to kick on at the top.
Yeah, they're looking to extend that lead at the top before Rangers go to Pittodrie and probably the game of the weekend on Sunday. But really tough for Motherwell. I don't think they expect to get anything at Celtic Park. They'll obviously give it their all, but the next few games after that, really important for Motherwell to get some points and try and climb up the league.
One of your Sky colleagues, of course, Chris Boyd, the other week now famously said Rangers will turn up for the game against Aberdeen, or Aberdeen will turn up for it, more the case. Is that the case? Do you reckon that Aberdeen are more up for the game with Rangers?
Well, you look at what happened the last time at Ibrox, and I think it was the Rangers players that chucked it. I think it was the Rangers players will be giving more at the weekend. There's a new manager. I think Aberdeen will give it everything, as they always do against Rangers, but you would imagine it's the Rangers players that will be given more. And remember, it was the Rangers fans that were calling them, what was it, passionless, leaderless, not long after it.
Can't wait for the game coming back, not least that game on Sunday, your old team Rangers up against Aberdeen. Clement, he wants to keep the winning continuing and going after this break.
Yep, this is he's obviously had his semi-final that he's won, but for me, this is his first real big test. I think, as we spoke about earlier, that historically going up to Aberdeen's always a real tough test. They will certainly be up for it after the comments that have been flying about. So, really looking forward to that and looking forward to see the outcome of it.
What was it like going to Aberdeen then as a Rangers player? I know it was COVID times as well, it was different, but there's so much needle. I mean, we know the history from decades ago. But what's it like these days?
Yeah, it's just a real tough place to go for anyone, not just Rangers. It's a real tough place for anyone in the league to go. So, as I said, looking forward to it. It's going to be a tough game for Rangers. They're on a good run since the new manager's come in. Aberdeen will be looking to go and get points on the board as well. They've had a just run. They've got themselves into the final as well, similar to Rangers. So it's an exciting game. We've got a few games before that coming up as well. So looking forward to the weekend ahead.
International football, we can park it for a little while, but it's great to be knowing you both played for Scotland. We'll be off to Germany. Who's going to be leading Ireland? They're not going to Germany. The reason we're mentioning it is, of course, Stephen Kenny was relieved of his duties last night. And the front runners, was Neil Lennon, apparently, according to the bookmakers this afternoon, the former Celtic and Hibs boss and former Northern Ireland captain, he could be the manager of Ireland. Roy Keane's been mentioned, and Lee Carsley as well, the England under 21 coach. Andy, could you see the Celtic hero, Neil Lennon, as the manager of Ireland?
Yeah, I don't see why not. He's got the success at club football. He's got a lot of experience under his belt. He's managed abroad as well. Maybe the next step is international management. But as you mentioned there, a lot of other big names in it. And having met Stephen Kenny a few weeks ago at a game down south, saw him after a game at Preston, and I think he realised, you know, it was really tough, and this was they were going up against games against, I think it was France at the time, and he realised that he maybe didn't have the quality of player that we normally associate with the Republic of Ireland, but a fantastic job for whoever gets it.
And everywhere he's been, he's picked up trophies. So could you see Neil Lennon in charge in Ireland?
Yeah, it would be a good job for him, as Andy's mentioned there. It's a good job for anyone. They've not got many generational players coming through at the minute, so he'll need to go and search and try and find these talents coming through. But it's a team that's not qualified for the last couple of tournaments, so if you can go in there and get them qualified for the next tournament, then it'll be a success.
A bit like the Scots, their fans, they bring so much to tournaments around the world. Lee Carsley, you've come up against him, haven't you, over the years?
Yeah, I've played against him, a real fierce competitor. I've spoke to a couple of people that have played in his under-21 squad in England, and he's very highly thought of. I know, I think Julian Lescott's in there as well, and I've spoke to him previously about him, and as I said, he's really highly thought of. So that's another one. If he goes in there, it's a great job for him as well. But I think the experience that Neil Lennon's got might just win it over for someone to him to go in.
Well, Graham Dorrans is here, Andy Walker too, and you can call them 0808 17 17 700. We'll be talking all things football for Scotland, the Championship as well, and the First and Second Division, and England. Andy, where are you going? You're going to one of the biggest games on the...
Yeah, very much looking forward to it. I'll be alongside my old mucker Ian Crocker on Saturday. Yeah. We're covering Newcastle against Chelsea, which will be really good. Chelsea tend to do it against the big teams. I know they've had some shocking results against the lower ranked sides in the Premier League in England, but they've taken points off Liverpool, Arsenal, they beat Spurs, and then of course they had that unbelievable game against Man City recently, so it should be really good at Newcastle.
Newcastle, of course, it's been quite a transformation, hasn't it, the last couple of years. Anthony Gordon, is he going to be a Scot, do you think, Graham? What do you reckon?
I think when these players come available, if it's Anthony Gordon, I think Harvey Barnes has been mentioned as well. I know Steve Clark's probably been loyal to his players so far, but when the talent like this comes up, I think they certainly need to be considered. I seen an article the other day that he was linked to maybe getting an England squad as well, Anthony Gordon. So he's certainly someone, if he's available, he has to be considered. And he's going to the Newcastle game on Saturday, so he'll be able to tell us more about it. I'll be down at Largs while he's enjoying himself in the Premier League. So.
I didn't want to be smart. That's the thing. Where are you this weekend? Because we know Johnston Borough. You've just answered it. So you're down there at. Is it into Nardini's first of all? I don't suppose so. After the game, if you win,
yeah,
maybe.
We'll go in there, yeah, I'll be pretty much in there. I think before it. Yeah. So we're down at Largs in another cup game. We've had the last 7 or 8 weeks. We've been all cup games. So we've not played in the league in a long time. So we've got another one on Saturday. So hopefully we can get a result again.
No sign of Anthony Gordon down there. Not at the moment. Andy, do you think? I mean, if you're Gareth Southgate, you're going to cap him soon, are you not? Although, it's not.
Yeah, I think you want to cap him, and you know, that's him committed. And you've got the option of using him if need be. The level of competition in that England squad, I mean, no wonder alongside France, they will be big favourites for that tournament next summer. But it would be great if we could get someone of his quality. Maybe the one thing that we really lack is absolute quality in the last third. We've got great defensive quality, midfield, people that can sit there, people that can create. But up front, if we had a really special player, it might make a difference for us.
I think the decision will be made not by him. It'll be by when the England squad gets named. If he's not in it, then his thoughts will probably turn to coming to play for Scotland. Some people might not like that, the fact that that's the case. But
do you think still?
Ultimately, that is it. If he's... He's English, he's born there. If they want to cap him and they want to pick him in the team, then I'm guessing here, but I think that might be his first choice. If they don't, he'll be thinking that he wants to go and play international football, and Scotland are now qualifying for tournaments, so why not if he's not capped it for England?
And you just bring with you Scott McTominay.
Absolutely.
Because remember when he came across at first, you'd be, what? But my goodness. And I don't think he regrets it either, does he?
Definitely not. I mean, the campaign that he just had here tells you that he certainly doesn't regret it. So, there's players down in England that you need to go and find that have got family and that are Scottish. So if we can get these players on board, then it's only going to help us as a country as well.
Who's going to win the tournament? Who do you think?
France will definitely be up there, favourites. As Andy mentioned, England have got great quality, but I think France for me will be the favourites. They've been really, really confident and playing really well going into it.
I wouldn't be surprised if England won it. When you look, if Bellingham is in top form, one of the best in the world right now, and you look at what is ahead of him, Foden, Grealish, Harry Kane, Rashford, if they're all in top form, you could see England winning it. The only thing you would think about is just the mentality that England have. They always talk about winning things. They're very rarely serious about doing it. It's always a quarter-final, semi-final that they'll get beat. And I think they've just got so much talent from middle to front.
This time yesterday we had Brendan Rodgers speaking just after the Celtic AGM. Which headline do you want to go to, Andy? We'll never sell the jerseys is the headline in the back of the Sun today. Dermot Desmond's son saying they'd never sell their shares to Saudi, for example. Those weren't the actual words he said. But another headline was that Brendan Rodgers said he's got the final say on who is coming to Celtic. There's a recruitment department. They identify the areas they need players, the kind of players that he wants, but he has the final say.
Yeah, it's the way it should be. It's maybe not always been that way, which led to the breakup of that relationship some years ago. But as he mentioned, Celtic are pretty much the same as everyone else. You will identify players, you'll give the manager or the head coach a number of options, and then together you sit down and see who is the best option in terms of price and what you might who you might fancy. So that is... That's all well and good. I think the big thing that Celtic fans want to see is just an improvement in European results. It's the one glaring omission from Celtic over the last number of years. They have been remarkably successful, but nowhere near it on the European stage, and that's a big downer for all the fans.
Big few days for Matt O'Reilly. So he made his debut for Denmark, and he spoke to the media this afternoon.
Yeah, it was nice. First cap of all, it's always a good moment. Albeit, like, probably wasn't our best performance, but at the same time, you're still playing for your country. So proud moment for me and family also. Yeah, family were there. Mum, dad, girlfriend and agent/friend kind of thing. Was always a target anyway. I think it's something I try not to think about too much on a regular basis, just more of a case of daily processes here, you know, the boring day-to-day kind of stuff, and then that usually helps you get to where you want to get to.
Great Danish accent, of course, because he was also the England system, and he's gone to Denmark. A bit more about his first cap.
Yeah, again, not something I probably give too much thought to. It's still just playing football at the end of the day, you know, so I think if I'm playing with good players and playing under a good manager, it shouldn't really be a problem to play well. And yeah, of course, I was disappointed with how the result was, etc. And I was obviously hard on myself after the game, because you naturally are when you lose, but at the same time, I received some nice feedback from people, right, regardless, which was nice.
Graham, when you watch him, what do you make of Matt O'Reilly?
Very good. Very, very good. Arguably player of the season so far. You just touch on there, he's an English-born midfielder now playing for Denmark. Yeah. So if countries that can do it, why can't we? But no, fair play, he's went and got his debut for Denmark there, and things are only on the up for him. I've seen the comments of linking him with Lampard, and maybe a little bit ahead of it there, but he's certainly got ability, certainly got talent, and if he keeps playing the way he is, he'll get that big move, I'm sure.
And he's the kind of player you'd pay money to watch?
Yeah, no, I think just as a striker, I can see that he has just a tremendous understanding, a tremendous relationship with the likes of Kyogo. Some of the goals that they've scored in the Champions League, they're just completely on the same wavelength, and they've been real highlights of Celtic's European campaign, the goals that they've sort of set up. But like Graham, I think he's probably the player of the season so far. Let's hope he remains injury free and he can play a lot more games.
He's been talking a bit more about playing for Denmark and also the work he's been doing off the field.
Yeah, I mean, I work a lot with Kevin Strachan as well, in terms of like my clips after games and speak about things we can do better. I don't know, for me the big thing just that's helped the most has just been in the best frame of mind and in my head. I think, you know, most people say when you feel good up in your head and in your mind, it naturally translates onto the pitch, and that's something I try to give a lot of attention to on a daily basis.
Matt O'Reilly certainly working for him. A bit more in his performances. You heard Graham Dorran saying there, if there was an award just now, which there isn't, but if there was, he could be the player of the year.
Feel good. Feel stronger physically and mentally, which is progress. Try to look at it from that perspective. As long as I'm improving, then naturally, you know, you're heading in the right direction. And I think I feel like I've improved a lot this season in various aspects, which is positive.
He's talking a lot there about the mental aspect of it, Graham.
Yeah, he's obviously working on that behind the scenes, things that people don't see. But the biggest thing for me is his confidence. He's, as we mentioned there, he's been the player of the season. He'll know that. He'll know he's playing well. And that rubs off. That rubs off on everyone. It rubs off on him as well. When he's going out on a Saturday, or whether it's going to play with Denmark, when he's confident, you see the ability he's got. So the sky's the limit for him, really.
Not too far away from December the 1st. And then a month later, it's going to be the transfer window opens. Some Rangers fans have been on. We talked last night. Ryan Kent doesn't seem to be going too well for him at the moment in Turkey. Could you see him coming to Ibrox in January?
Yes, it's someone that's been here and done it. Obviously, the last 3 or 4 months of his spell went downhill a little bit, but it will be determined by if the manager has seen enough of him and if he sees fit to bring him back in. He might have come in, and if he's got his own players and own people that he wants to bring in, but in terms of what he can bring, you've seen that. Rangers are probably lacking players in the wide area. They've got McCausland coming through, who's probably the only real winger at the minute, Matondo being injured. So definitely it's an area that needs improved and needs numbers in. So if there's an opportunity to get them back, then I think they should, yeah.
Could you see it? Do you think it would work, Andy?
I'm not sure. I mean, he didn't really seem to have his focus. He didn't really seem committed in the last months of his time at Rangers. He knew that his contract was running down. His mind was clearly elsewhere, whatever options that he had at the time. He's gone to Turkey. I don't know how much it's worked out for him or not, how much he's enjoying it. But I think he's definitely the type of player Rangers could do with, you know, a special player in a wide area, someone who can create, someone who can carry the ball 20, 30, 40 yards. And I think Rangers are missing that type of player. And it'll be really interesting to see what type of player, what position that Philippe Clement wants to strengthen. And of course, how much money he's given to strengthen.
Of course, you were in the position where you were at Celtic, then you went down south and you came back. Now, yeah, it's a longer period of time than this because it's only, what, 4 or 5 months since Ryan Kent left. But yeah.
I felt as though I came back a better player, but I didn't come back to a better team. I mean, the team that I played alongside when I got to Celtic first time around was just full of experience and I was able to blend in well there. But the team I came back to was just not the same quality.
We're talking Rangers for a moment or two, but it's not. It's Lewis Ferguson. But he could have been at Rangers, could have been at Celtic as well. So he went not that long ago to Bologna, and I see that Juventus are now lining up. They're seeing a €20 million bid for him. Andy, no surprise there, probably.
Well, just to see not only how well he settled on the pitch, but we've all seen the clips of him, how well he settled off it, the fact that he's learned the language so quickly, he seems really confident about everything that he's doing, he's getting a wee bit of international experience. I think his goal now will be to hopefully remain injury-free, try and get on that plane to the Euros, and I'm really not surprised that big clubs are looking at him. The surprise to all of us was that Celtic Rangers didn't take him.
Yeah, I've watched a fair bit of him since he's been over there. Very, very talented. Actually surprised me a little bit because I didn't see too much of him at Aberdeen. So when he went over there, I like to look out for players that try something new. So I watched him. Very, very good player. I mean, he gets his sail in the box. He's very fit. So it's no surprise that these teams are coming in and looking at him. But I think it's a mistake that Rangers and Celtic did miss out on him. I think Rangers maybe had a small opportunity to bring him in before he went. I think they probably should have, but yeah, he's only going to go into better things, and you can see that with the teams that he's linked with, Juventus, and I think as Andy mentioned there, I think his next step for him is to try and cement a place in that national team and get on the plane.
He's on that plane, isn't he?
Yeah, he should be. I mean, if he keeps up these performances that he's been producing, then definitely he has to be. There's obviously competition for places in that area in the Scotland squad, but for me, you should definitely be on that plane, yes.
That'll be one of the things, Andy, won't it, in the coming months as we get closer to June, and Germany will be injuries. And we've been unlucky with the injury to Andy Robertson, and probably more particularly because it's been for a longer period, to Kieran Tierney.
Yeah, another one who I think has cemented his place is Lauren Shanklin. To get that goal against Georgia in the manner that he did, I'd seen him the weekend before when he was at Fir Park, scored a couple of goals. Just as usual, as a captain of Hearts, he's leading the line really well. Alec Lowry was another star player on that afternoon. But, Shankland, I think, will have cemented his place after that big goal.
Ross McCausland, if you were at your old club, Rangers, if you were in charge, would you be getting that contract signed with him? They probably thought, get it signed before you go on international duty.
Yeah, I mean, he's a young lad that's came through, took his opportunity. I watched him in the Sparta game and he was very, very good when he came on. Got a start against Livingston and done well that game as well. But he's now a 20-year-old boy, so he has to get game time. He has to be playing. I think at the minute, if he was to go down to a Premier League club, I don't think he would be going to get minutes. I think he would be a project for someone. So I think for someone like that who's just came through, I think he should stay at Rangers, sign a new contract, maybe get 50 or 100 games for Rangers and then look to move. I think he's certainly got ability, like I said. He can pick a pass, he can beat a man, but I think to make the next step, he needs to get his physicality up a little bit, maybe work on that in the gym for the next 6 months or a year if he wants to make that step to the Premier League, because that's another level. That's something, when I made that jump, that it stuck out for me so much, going from the Championship in England to the Premier League, that the elite level players of your Gerrards, Lampards. Mm-hmm. You see them on the TV and you think, yeah, good players, but you actually see them in real life and you think, specimen, wow, an absolute athlete.
Even just seeing them coming down the tunnel.
So if people like McCausland and they want to make that jump to the Premier League, he needs to just get a little bit more physicality in him.
I think it also tells you how difficult it is. Imagine Rangers did get Ryan Kent back. Yeah. I mean, McCausland's not going to play in front of him, and that's how difficult it is for every young player who's got a bit of potential. And we say it all the time, as former players, you need to play to develop. And whether it's whether he gets regular games at Rangers or elsewhere, he needs to improve, and you can only do that when you're playing on a weekly basis.
Imagine how he would feel if he did play second fiddle if Ryan Kent were to come back, if the wages and all that can be sorted, because Ryan Kent was off the boil for quite some time. And what does that say to Ross McCausland?
He's at an age now of 20, he's not really young in football anymore, so he has to be playing. I mean, he has to go out and cement his place in that team. And like Andy says, if Ryan Kent comes in, he's not coming in to play behind Ross McCausland, so he'll be coming in to be the first choice winger, and then that might make a decision for that McCausland's got to make after that.
The Go Radio Football Show with Global Eco Energy. Contact the team now to help make your home more energy efficient.
Let's go. Go Radio Football Show. It's Thursday night. We're only one day, 21 hours and 30 minutes away from kickoff in the Cinch Scottish Premiership, and the games we have: St Mirren against Livingston. There's something in every single game, isn't there, Andy Walker and Graham Dorrans? Ross County under new management up against Kilmarnock. Hearts against St Johnson, the Craig Levein derby. And he said he's looking forward to booze. No surprise there. Craig comes into town. Dundee against Hibernian and Celtic against Motherwell. And then Sunday, Aberdeen Rangers, 12 noon. Some weekend coming up, Graham, isn't it? It's looking to... Were you surprised at Ross County? Derek Adams, you know him well. I think you know him quite well. Back in the game. The third time back at a club.
Well, I was surprised when Malky lost his job. I mean, he's done an incredible job up there. I think he's very highly thought of as a coach as well. So, firstly, I was surprised when he lost his job. And yeah, I was probably a little bit surprised that they went for to bring Derek Adams back in for a third spell, I think it was, having left Morecambe during the week. But that's a big game for them at the weekend. Home to Kilmarnock, new manager bounce. They'll be expecting to get 3 points and get off to a flyer for the new manager coming in.
Quick word, what about one of your old teams, Hibs, up against Dundee? Dundee, the surprise package, along with St Mirren, maybe, in the first...
Yeah, I've been really impressed with the way Dundee have settled in life in the top flight. They've got a good number of points. They're comfortably in that top six. But you know what it's like, Paul. You can just as easily get into that losing habit. And Hibs are capable of going to most places, creating chances. They've got goal scorers in their team. I actually fancy an away win there.
Okay, more of that in the second hour. Let's go back to the Celtic AGM. There's nothing from Rangers today. I would imagine that'll be tomorrow because it's the Sunday game. The new cycle, the way it works, Andy, you know it well. You've worked in it for quite a bit of time. So yesterday, Brendan Rodgers, after the AGM, was speaking to the media and asked a number of questions, including about the squad and strengthening it and what he feels about
it. My job here, of course, is to develop the football team, and I want the best football team on the field. But it will always be within the conditions of the club. Every manager will be the same. You strive to get the best quality players in order to improve your performance level. So hopefully we'll be able to do that in our time. But it's a difficult window. Of course, there's always quality available, but it's whether it's affordable for us is the challenge. But in my previous jobs, I've done really good business in January windows when they have been available. So it's something that's been ongoing really through the course of the last few months, looking at the possibilities of players that we might be able to bring in. But I repeat, I don't want to add to the squad. We've got a squad of 32, which we need to bring down, as well as bringing in quality players. But I'm fairly comfortable that come by the summer, over the course of these next few windows, that the squad, both in terms of numbers and quality, will look how I want it to.
What's your view on that?
Yeah, I think he's obviously got a very clear view of what he wants. To trim the squad, to get more quality. The big problem is to try and improve results. You see how much teams are spending in the Champions League. You look at Paris Saint-Germain, you look at Man United, you look at teams like Benfica. They've got very few points, they're bottom of the group. And that's why I've always said I don't think Celtic are interested in spending 10 or even more million pounds on a player to improve their performances in the Champions League. It looks as though they just want to be ahead of Rangers domestically. And I think Brendan Rodgers is talking about moments in games and, you know, the fact that they're competing for small periods in games in the Champions League. It's the same last season under Ange Postecoglou. It looked exciting. It looked as though they were competing, but they weren't getting any points. And this is a familiar story. Celtic will always want to be in the Champions League. This idea that maybe they suit the Europa League is better. The best way of getting into the Europa League is actually winning the title, getting into the Champions League, and actually picking up, I don't know, 4, 5, 6, 7 points that can get you dropped down into the Europa League and see how you go from there.
And it's a model that's worked commercially, hasn't it? The balance sheet at Celtic is...
it's very impressive. Yeah. And, you know, Rangers' numbers come out recently, wasn't so impressive. And this was after a year where, you know, Aribo, Calvin Bassey, Champions League money. And this is a really important league season because the format and the makeup of the Champions League next season is going to change. It's going to be even more lucrative. It makes it a really, really important title this season.
But they want to get the pulses racing of the fans. And ultimately,
that's what you want.
Beating Rangers or Rangers to beat Celtic is what it's about. But the European tradition of Celtic, it's something that was special.
Yeah, for supporters of a certain vintage, it was in your psyche. It was in the absolute makeup of your team. Yeah. Those early 70s, going into the 80s. Yeah. Then, of course, everything changes, and you hear all this noise about the teams at the top getting so far away. It's the same with Celtic and Rangers in Scotland. They are getting stronger and stronger and pushing themselves further and further away from Hibs, Hearts, Aberdeen, anyone else you care to mention. And it's the same down in England. The Big Four or the Big Six, they are so far away from the bottom half of the English Premier League, it's frightening.
Graham, as someone who played with Rangers, how do you view what's happening at Celtic money-wise and, you know, all that cash? What do you feel? Did you think they would spend more? Or?
I think they're going to have to spend in January because they will lose some players, especially to the Asian Cups. But the goal at the start of the season is always to go and win the league. As fans, when we're watching the games, we want the teams to go and do well in Europe. I've seen Rangers get to Europa League for UEFA Cup final and Europa League final in the last 10 or so years. But teams like Feyenoord and Copenhagen, they're competing in the Champions League. They're going to Old Trafford and competing. So why can't Rangers and Celtic get to that level and compete? And as Andy says, you always want to get in the Champions League. And if you can go and get 6 or 7 points, and if that gets you into the Europa League after that, then you can have a go at that. But the ambition has to be more successful in the Champions League and try and get through to the latter knockout stages.
I'm talking about recent years when you can drop into Champions League. I know it's all changed next season. Sure. You won't be able to do that. But I think that's where Rangers have the edge over Celtic in the last number of years. Their results in Europe have been so impressive to get to another Europa League final. I mean, we keep saying it wasn't that long ago. And it's something that is, I think, sadly lacking for Celtic, some of those big occasions where you take a really notable scalp.
Here's a bit more from Brendan Rodgers on the signing policy and the things that worked over the years.
Everyone will put the quality down to the number that you pay, but that's not necessarily... I think Virgil van Dijk was 2 million when he came in here, so that was good quality. It's always the challenge because lots of players may want to place in a more competitive league or one of the renowned leagues. But I think what Celtic offers here is really unique in terms of the opportunity to come and play for a fanatical fan base, to come and develop as a player, to become a winner, to live in a great city. And there's been many players and managers that whilst they've been here, and it's sometimes only when you are here, that you get that real sense of that. So we always work hard, but we want big players to come. This is an incredible club to come and play for, and if you're lucky enough to be able to come here and work and play, you'll get the sense of that. So So, yeah, so that's something that's ongoing.
Let's go on the line, 0808 17 17 700. And the Rangers fan, Paul, is on the line. Good evening, Paul.
Evening, Paul. Great show, as always.
Thank you.
Thanks for letting me on.
Pleasure.
I was listening to your conversation there about budgets and things like that for Celtic and Rangers. And
yeah.
I just wanted to, you know, I told you just before, and I said, no, Rangers a couple of years ago got to Europa League final. But the transfer budget we did was remarkable, to be honest. £2.5 million we spent that year on transfers, and we got to a European final. So I suppose my point is, I hear a lot of Celtic fans and pundits and whatnot saying Celtic's got £72 million in the bank, blah, blah, blah. But I suppose all that money doesn't really get...
Does that really wind you up, Paul? Paul, does that really wind you up? They've got 75, 72 million or whatever. Sorry, on you go.
Well, actually, I would like the money in my account, but...
Yeah, we wouldn't mind it here either, would we, Graham? Andy? No, okay.
I think my point is, to Celtic fans, I think it's not based on the money. I mean, you see these teams down south that are flattering. How much does Chelsea spend?
Too much.
Like millions of pounds.
Yeah.
And look what they're getting. I mean, it's an overinflated market, and I think they're wise money men, do you know what I mean? And I think, I can understand, you know, you want the best players, I get all of that, but... You've just got to be careful with what you spend money on, I suppose. You know,
sure. What about your own club? What about Ryan Kent? Is that a possibility, or would you want him back? Forget the money. Would you want him back, or did he switch off last season?
I think he's been found out, Paul, in his new club, and I think, to be honest, he underperformed at a number of times. The Rangers have just continued to get fed up by Gerrard and from Brokhorst and that. I mean, I went...
Yeah. Oh, you've gone there.
Killed my trust with him.
Uh-huh.
The one that killed my trust with him was the last Old Firm game in the Cup. He just switched completely off. And you know what? There's a lot of fans. I don't like to do that. A lot of fans.
It's a bad line now, but we've got your point. Graham, what would you say about Ryan Kent when you hear, for example, Paul's view?
There's no doubt that in the last 4 or 5 months his contract at Rangers, that he wasn't performing. There's no questions about that. But in terms of his ability... I came up against him in training many a times. He's certainly got bags of ability. If he can produce and get to his top level, which he did for a time period in a Ranger jersey, then it's a no brainer for me to bring him back. But it has to be right. It has to be right financially. He has to be in the right frame of mind, and he has to give 100% like he did before. If his performances are going to be the same level as you were getting for the last 4 or 5 months, and he's not fully committed to what he's given, then it goes the other way and you would say no.
There weren't many Rangers players who were scoring goals against Celtic at Parkhead and at Ibrox. Ryan Kent was one of them, and I know he frustrated Rangers supporters for a long time, but I think he had great ability, and it's the type of player I think Rangers need in the second half of the season.
Paul, how much are you looking forward to Pittodrie, and what do you think? Andy made a great point earlier on, you know, the Chris Boyd thing, saying, oh, you know, Aberdeen always turn up against... But actually, Aberdeen turned up at Ibrox not that long ago. What are you feeling for Sunday?
I think Club Odds certainly instilled a bit of steel about Rangers, though. We're certainly not conceding as many goals. I think we've conceded maybe 3 goals under his tenure, I think it is. And we're scoring at the other end as well, and I think you'll see a different animal. I mean, I went to the game at Ibrox, and it was the poorest performance. I think it was just a death knell in Bielefeld's tenure at Rangers, obviously. And I think, look, I've been supporting Rangers a long time, and you guys are older than me. Not to give away my age or anything, right? But they're definitely a competitive edge. I can get Boyd's point of view, the Razor game, and I get all of that, right, but they're certainly a competitive edge. And I've heard a lot of Aberdeen fans phoning into radio shows saying whether Rangers fans like it or not, we're rivals to them. They're not rivals, because at the end of the day, we've been dominant in Scottish football for more years than they have, and I don't see them as a rival, to be honest. So I think we'll beat them, and I think we'll beat them in the cup final as well, and I think that'll drive the board on that.
That's my point, Paul, was that it will be the Rangers players who'll be given more, because it was Rangers supporters that brought out a banner that said their players were heartless and passionless, and that's what they were in the game that you were at Ibrox. But Aberdeen, you would expect to give it everything against Rangers. It was the Rangers players who did not give everything that day.
Can I come back?
Yeah, sure, on you go.
Listen, see, the last four games, do you know the aggregate score between Celtic and Aberdeen? 18-1. I think it is 18-1 aggregate score. Now, I'm not 1 minute putting on blue tinted specs and saying there's a conspiracy and all. I'm not about that. But it certainly makes you as a Rangers fan question why a team can come. Now, I'm not just talking about Ibrox in that game, but certainly you look back at all the other Rangers and Celtic, Rangers and Aberdeen games. We certainly don't spank them 5-6-0 many times, and it does frustrate me, I suppose, why there's an imbalance here and why that possibly is. And I'm not doing that as a conspiracy theory. I'm not into all that nonsense, do you know what I mean? So, look, Andy, you'll remember a certain Mr. Sutton had blamed Dunfermline and Jimmy Calderwood for lying down against Rangers. Oh, I think that was nonsense.
Come back, conspiracy theories. That's yesterday's date, isn't it? The conspiracy theories over in Dallas, the tragic events of 60 years ago. Graham, you're there, a wry smile on your face. What would you say to Paul?
It's certainly going to be a tough game. I mentioned earlier, it's going to be the biggest test that Rangers have faced, in my opinion, since the new managers come in. I do feel that I'm not going to question the integrity of Aberdeen, but it's certainly always a tougher game when they play against Rangers. Is that because they do see it as a rivalry? Is that because they go up there and their fans are up for it and it's louder and they get behind their team more and it gives the players a lift? That may be the case, but whatever it is, Rangers have certainly came up against a much tougher side against Aberdeen than I would say Celtic have. And you look at the results, as you mentioned, they're 18-1 in the last four games. I don't know, as I said, if it's just because they do see it as a rivalry and they're lifting the game. Similarly, when Rangers play Celtic, every player always wants to lift their game and it's fiercely competitive, so that may be the case.
The one thing Boydie's done is he's sold this game beautifully.
He has, hasn't he? Yeah.
I mean, everybody will be watching it.
The other thing is, Celtic have been better over this period of time, you know, by quite a margin, apart from the year when Rangers won the title there. So that's also in the equation, isn't it? If it is conspiracy theories and you looked at it, you'd say, yeah, but Celtic were winning the titles at that point. Therefore, a better team. Paul, you sparked another debate, you and Chris Boyd, and Andy's putting a good point. So too is Graham. It's the Go Radio Football Show. Thanks, Paul.
The Go Radio Football Show with Global Eco Energy. Reduce your energy bills with the latest renewable energy products.
Let's go back on the lines, 0808 17 17 700. Graham Dorrans, the former Rangers, West Bromwich Albion and Scotland star, along with Andy Walker. Sheffield United, Bolton Wanderers, Celtic and Scotland. Kevin's on the line. Good evening, Kevin.
How are you doing, boys? You all right?
Good. How excited are you that football is back? When I mean football, the Cinch Premiership.
Excited that we're going to come back, mate. I like the international break.
Yeah.
But it's good to get back to the bread and butter. And Paul, I did tell you last week when I was on, I speak to you and Barry, about his Christmas advent and all that. I did say we would take 3 or 4 off Georgia, but I didn't expect to concede.
That's true.
But I look forward to playing Motherwell Saturday, mate. So they're obviously had a bit of a bad patch, Motherwell, but I'm looking forward to getting back and hopefully we can just pick up where we left off and just keep the momentum going, really. Just try to steamroll us through the rest of 2023 and just get pick up a positive run of results. But
have you any concerns? Can I just ask you, so one of the breaking stories, it's not breaking today, but it came out of yesterday, what's happening with the Green Brigade? Some of them banned at the moment, home and away. Okay, so the latest is that they're giving an update about they're calling it a day of action on Saturday, the match with Motherwell. And they're saying that we will liaise with all interested Celtic fans groups and the Celtic supporters clubs. A statement from them is saying, Saturday, they're looking to come to the Celtic Way. So it looks as though they're going to be there to protest before the game. So they're not going to be at the game, some of them, but they're going to be outside. Celtic have said they wanted the right kind of dialogue. I'm not sure what the latest is at the moment. Have you any update, Kevin?
I've not heard anything, mate. I've been on X, as they call it now, and stuff like that. I've not really seen anything apart from just fan opinion, but from what I can see, Paul, I'll be honest with you, it's kind of split 50-50, if I'm being honest, between fans about whether or not they should turn up at Celtic Park Saturday. Mm. Some fans are saying, stay away, don't cause any bother, but I think then the other ones are, I think the main point is they're not going to cause any trouble, they're just going to protest. But listen, as long as they don't embarrass the club any further than they've already done, I've not got a problem with them turning up, as long as it's a kind of peaceful adult protest, then, you know what I mean, that's fine. I did criticise them the last time I was on, mm-hmm. and said, you know, they need to learn their lesson. I'm not going to give my opinion on what's going on the terrible things that are happening there, but yeah. I've got my own opinion, but I keep that to myself and away from football, because there's no place for it in a football stadium, especially when we have such amazing Israeli players play for us in the past and wandering out of Baghdad, right? I think it's disrespectful. But anyway, as long as they keep it amicable, I don't have an issue with it, Paul, to be honest. My personal opinion is, I think between the club and the Green Brigade, they need to have some positive dialogue and sort of get them back in the stadium and let bygones be bygones, because the fans, Celtic gives me anything, but Celtic also need to maybe appreciate the fan base that they've got as well, which I'm sure they do. But
Andy, this is a really difficult one, isn't it?
Yeah, listen, I've said before, I think there's a lot of good stuff that the Green Brigade do. I've highlighted it before, their charitable work, their collections for food banks, for various good causes. You have to admire that. In my view, I'm not interested in anyone's political stance when I go to the football. I'm not a fan of them glorifying in the IRA. I'm not a fan of the abuse of the king and the crown. All of that you can do without any offensive singing, offensive banners. And if it is true that they are storming some grounds and physically attacking stewards of other clubs, clearly that's unacceptable. And I think there's a lot of, if indeed there is going to be some sort of resolution, there is a lot of dialogue to be made.
Graham, it's a difficult one. All clubs have issues with fans at times. This is a difficult one. I'm not asking you as a former Rangers player to comment on the Green Brigade, but I guess what you know is that if a club is united, it gives you a great chance to move forward.
I think in general, any club, if there's rules and there's guidelines to follow, and if that club feels that that section of the sport is not following them, then they're going to take action. If there's evidence there that obviously they must have to take this action that they've took. So as I say, that you have to follow the guidelines, whether it's Rangers, Celtic, Aberdeen, whoever it is. There's rules there, and if they're not following, abiding by the rules, if they're causing troubles getting into away games and fighting with stewards or whatever it is they're accused of, then there's going to be action taken. And whether that goes to points deduction or whatever from the SFA, I don't know. But this has been dragged on for a little bit too long now. I think they need to get together and draw a line under it one way or another.
Steady on the points deduction there, the former Rangers star.
Steady,
exactly. Andy,
it's not a matter for the SFA, any points deduction in the SPFL.
Indeed, I know. It'd be great to get this sorted, wouldn't it?
Dialogue is the only way that you'll get some sort of resolution, but good behaviour is another one. I mean, in my experience, you know, we didn't have the Green Brigade at when I played the old Celtic, if you like, but there was certainly enough noise around the stadium. If you look a month ahead when Celtic play Rangers, I'm sure it'll be a sellout. Sadly, there'll be no away supporters there, but that's what the both clubs want. And I think the atmosphere then, the level of noise you'll get, it'll be as you would expect in a game like that.
Let's hear Matt O'Reilly, and you'll be pleased that he got his cap the other night. Hopefully many more for him. He's been talking about the game coming up at the weekend with Motherwell, the game that you're looking forward to as well. He's been speaking about his own performances and about scoring more goals. And the manager said to him at the start of the season, the new manager said, "We want more goals from you."
Clear of mind, first and foremost, just more open when I'm on the pitch. Secondly, just continuously getting into the right positions to score. And then, just taking a little bit of pressure off myself, not expecting myself to score every game, just going into it, you know, trying to do my best for the team. And then naturally, you kind of get your outcomes.
And this is what his manager said about the opposition, Motherwell.
Yeah, I just think it's the league. There's a number of teams in that sort of position. I think we had a really good game against them. And Stuart's an excellent young coach who's developing the style there. And like I said, I thought when I seen them play, they were very well coached. and they work very hard. So so for us, we will give them that respect. We come back after an international break. We have to very quickly get the team synchronised again and start off where we left off in our last home game. So, but we'll prepare for a tough game, but our focus very much on working how we want to.
Kevin, what's your prediction then for the game? Is it 3-3?
No, I'll not be 3. Come on, you behave yourself, Paul.
that was referenced the other night when you thought Scotland would score 3 or 4, and you were right, but so too did Georgia. Aye, what do you reckon Saturday?
I think maybe two or three. I think if we've got they're on a slippery slope now, but they have got some decent players there, and Kettlewell. He's a good coach, so I actually like him, so I hope he does well the rest of the season apart from against us. But two or three, I don't think it's going to be a hammer whatsoever. I think international, it came back after the international break can be a wee bit of a funny one, so I think we'll get the 3 points, but it's certainly not going to be a walkover. I think we'll need to work hard for it.
I think Motherwell will be really wary. I mean, I saw them lose 4 at home to Aberdeen. You saw what Celtic did to Aberdeen just recently, took 6 off them at Parkhead. So after the international break, looking at everyone coming back from their travels, Celtic will be massive favourites to win that comfortably. It's the next few games after that are going to be so important for Motherwell and for Stuart Kettlewell.
Kevin, thanks for the call. News is next.
The Go Radio Football Show with Global Eco Energy. Reduce your energy bills with the latest renewable energy products.
Let's go! Racing towards the weekend, the Go Radio Football Show with Global Eco Energy. And tomorrow night at this time, it's going to be Barry Ferguson who'll be here with Stephen McGinn. Tonight, we're in the company of Graham Dorrans and Andy Walker. Quite a few calls in the first hour. Give us a buzz. 0808 17 17 700 if you're looking forward to your team in action this weekend. Rangers fans, what are you thinking? Aberdeen Rangers on Sunday, arguably match of the day for sure. It's the only one there, but it's match of the weekend probably when the Old Firm are away from home or the Glasgow Giants are away from home. It's a huge one. Graham, we've been talking about it in the first hour. Philippe Clement then, the report after the first, it's only 5 or 6 weeks since he came. It was almost unblemished. Was it 6 wins and a draw?
Yep, I think the draw came in the Europa League. He's won all his league games so far. There's a big month and a half coming up now before the split that he almost needs to go perfect in, I would think. He's got a big game starting on Sunday, a real tough one, and then he's got a couple followed up in the Europa League that they'll be looking to get qualified in, and then the cup final as well. So he'll be looking to have a perfect record going into the break and claw some points back before that.
I think you'll learn a lot about Rangers and what Philippe Clement thinks about his players this month. Aberdeen at the weekend, Aberdeen in the cup final, Celtic towards the end of the month. It's a remarkably busy month for games, December, as it always is. It'll test the depth of the squad, the quality of the squad, and we'll know a lot more about Rangers' challenge once we get to the 1st of January.
Jimmy's been on the socials, a big Rangers fan, and he wants to know who you would start. Not the whole team necessarily, but what have you found out about the team? You know, the winners, those that he reckons they're nailed on for the Philippe Clement team. For example, up top, is it Danilo as your out-and-out striker?
Yeah, I think at the minute it is. Definitely, he's hit a bit of form since he's come back from injury. So in terms of the striking options, yeah, I would definitely go Danilo. I think Sima's been very good as well after probably a slow start. The last couple of months, he's been very good. So definitely have him in. And then obviously the question is whether it's Cantwell, McCausland, Lammers. I think Ross McCausland's probably done enough to earn his place in the team, but It's a huge game, as I said, going up to Aberdeen. It's going to be tough. Whether he'll think that he's ready to go into a game of that magnitude, I don't know. But I think he seems to be sticking with Lammers and behind Danilo at the minute.
He isn't he? And that surprised some people at the beginning.
Yeah, because he's had a real tough start. I think there's definitely something in there. I watch him and he's got some nice touches and some nice movement. He's obviously not producing his numbers at the minute. He's not getting enough goals and assists. He managed to get a goal against Dundee. It was a great finish. I thought after that I'd maybe give him a bit of confidence to kick on. He didn't really. But the manager seems to be showing faith in him. And hopefully he can repay that faith.
What about Cantwell? he was taken off just after the first half, just the other week before the break. And Michael Beale, he was a regular. He was there all the time. What are you thinking with Cantwell? Could he be?
Yeah, as you mentioned, there, so the new manager's come in. He's probably not been as the focal star man that he was under Michael Beale before. He's took him off in the semi-final that didn't seem happy about. But ultimately that was the right decision because Rangers came out the second half and performed better and win the game. And then he comes on against Livingston, and I just don't like the whole social media thing of going after the game and putting up tackles and challenges and say this should be a yellow card and this is VAR. It's just a bit of nonsense for me. Concentrating playing football, you're at one of the biggest teams in the UK, so concentrating what you're doing in there, forget about VAR and forget about anything else in social media.
He's not 100% focused. If you're doing all that rubbish on social media, how much time is it taking? And I think the manager's seen through him to get him off at half-time, I think was the right call. And this new manager, doesn't matter what relationship you had previously, either with the supporters or previous coaches or previous managers, you need to be doing it for him. I think he's pretty calm. I think he's pretty measured. And you've always got to remember, he also said when he was first introduced, I'm not a magician. He knows he needs new players. So if people that can't well are causing him a bit of grief, I think he would think nothing of just leaving him out of the team.
Were you at Norwich at the same time when he was coming through as a youngster?
Yeah, he was just coming through when I was there. Someone I've spoke about previously before he came to Rangers, definitely got bags of ability, but always had that little bit about him with he loves the social media, the dancing when he scores a goal and things like that, stuff that I don't like it. Concentrate in your football, and if he does that, like I said, he's someone that's certainly got ability, so if he puts his 100% focus into that, we'll see the best Todd Cantwell.
Mm-hmm. Andy, what do you feel about Lammers? Have you seen enough? Because the manager has kind of persisted with him. Great goal against Dundee the other week.
I've just seen the improvement in Rangers under the new manager. I think before you couldn't put your hand on anyone to say this is a guy who's really turned it around for Rangers, apart from Jack Butland. I think everyone would accept he's added a bit of quality to Rangers. He's actually won them points with some big saves at important times. I think Rangers are getting better, but I'll go back to what I said a few minutes ago. You'll learn a lot more about Rangers in this coming month. The two games against Aberdeen that come up in quick succession, one away, one at Hampden. And then, of course, the game against Celtic when they're really up against it.
And looking elsewhere in the midfield and the defence for you, we all know Jack Butland's been outstanding success. Yilmaz or Barisic? Yilmaz, apparently, contract time. I mean, he's in contract for some time. He was a big money signing, but hasn't played enough games. And there's murmurings about, maybe he would want to be elsewhere.
Yeah, I think when the managers first came in, I thought he was more leaning towards Yilmaz because he played more of the games to start with, and then Barisic has come in and done well. But I think what Barisic gives you more than Yilmaz does is his delivery. I spoke about numbers earlier on. Barisic always chips in with an assist or a goal. Yilmaz isn't as good going forward as Barisic, I would say. Talking on Jack Butland as well, I see him linked with teams like Birmingham. He's a better player than that. Yeah. I mean, he's And he's at a better club than that. So for me, he won't be going to a club like Birmingham. I think if he keeps doing what he does, there's no way exception that he can go back down and go to a Premier League team. I don't think it's a step up leaving Rangers to go to Birmingham.
For sure. The Blues, even though they're the Blues. Andy, could he be back in the England squad? Jack Butland?
No, I don't think so.
Okay.
I think that's maybe a step too far. If only for the fact that every time I go down south and you speak to people about Scottish football, they just don't rate it.
Is it getting worse? The way they perceive
worse?
Us?
I don't know. Well, maybe results in Europe might, 6-0 against Athletic Madrid doesn't do Celtic any favours. But just in general, that type of feeling, I don't know what you think, Graham, but
definitely.
I have sensed that over the last number of years. I'm not so sure it's getting worse, Paul. I think it's just ingrained into the English media, the English fan, the English psyche, really, about Scottish football.
Yeah, there's only one game, having played there for 10 years, there's only one game that anybody pays attention to down there is when Rangers play Celtic. That's it. They don't bother about Rangers versus Hearts or Celtic versus Livingston. It's the Old Firm that you might get people watching. But other than that, then, as Andy said, I think probably the results in Europe and stuff is probably putting it down a little bit in terms of the eyes in England. But as I said, it's only one game that gets a bit of attention when you're in England.
What have you been thinking about Balogun? Obviously, he's not in the squad for Europe. I think that's right, isn't it? So, but Balogun, is he maybe not surprised you, but he's been a plus?
Yeah, he's definitely been a plus. I was probably a little bit surprised when they brought him back, but he's been a good option. He's come in, he's done well in the games that he's played in. He's a very strong defender. He's got a good partnership with Goldson. So, yeah, when he's came in, he's done very well. Disappointing not to have him in the European squad. So, definitely a plus that he's come back and he's playing well.
Andy, on Balogun and the European squad, the manager, Clément, has mentioned it. He's not throwing shade on the previous manager.
Yeah, I think the reason they brought in the number for the squads, I think it was to almost control the huge clubs. Yeah. The clubs with massive amounts of money so that they're committed to whatever it is, 23, 25, 26, whatever the number is. And it's unfortunate he's not registered to play. I mean, I think Rangers will win their European game this week. I think they're a much improved side under Clément, and they're playing in my view, the weakest team in the group. So they should win that, especially at Ibrox. And I think Balogun's got a lot to offer. I always thought he was a decent player.
A lot coming up, of course. So Rangers got the big game on Sunday, Aberdeen, and then Limassol, well, a week tonight, isn't it, Graham? They'll be in town. And that, it's not a grudge, but they'll feel they've got to right what was wrong because they played so poorly over there.
Yeah, definitely. I mentioned previously the last time I was on that the Rangers game against Sparta was the big one. I think the winner of that will really fancy themselves to go through to the next round. And as you mentioned there, Rangers will feel a little bit of a revenge to get back from Aris and the performance over there, because that performance was well below par. So they'll be looking to go out next week and put that wrong here, right?
Thankfully, we're not in the qualifiers. We are there for Germany. I just see John Hartson was in your seat last night.
Right.
So it's Finland, I see,
the
semi-final,
the first
one.
Finland, I think he should be. It's at home.
Yep.
Great record there. And then it's the winners of Poland and whoever they play again at home. So can't ask for more than that.
Some strong stuff coming from a Scottish Premiership manager in the last few moments. Stuart Kettlewell, the Motherwell boss, has criticised trigger-happy Premiership club chiefs regarding the disgrace, he called it, over the heavy recent managerial casualties. So himself, a former Ross County manager, insists that all managers, himself included, need time to create an atmosphere at a club and a long-term plan. He says, I'm not trying to defend myself from anything, because currently, obviously, Motherwell are in a bad run, but the fact I'm now the fourth longest serving manager in the division, and I've only been in the post since February, is a disgrace. That's what he said, Andy.
It's brutal. Management is brutal. I look at Rangers, I totally understand why they made a change this season. I look at Hibs, totally understand why they made a change this season. Lee Johnson to Nick Montgomery. St Johnson won, really tough on Stephen McLean, a young guy who they obviously felt was good enough to emulate the type of success that Callum Davidson had. Ross County, I didn't understand that one. I'm sure Malky Mackay would have kept them up, but I think it just highlights management is absolutely brutal, and your life can be turned upside down in the space of 4-6 weeks if results go against you.
Yeah, as Andy mentioned there, it's a results-driven business, so ultimately if you're not achieving the results that the upstairs above you wants, then you're obviously the cult in that. But yeah, I agree, some of the time frames that managers get these days, it's not long enough. I think when you appoint someone, you need to give them a full backing and their full belief that they can do and get the achievements that you're looking for. I think, as you mentioned there, it was a really surprise that Ross County decided to change a manager, but time will tell whether it's the right decision when the new manager comes in and they see the results coming up.
You also hear how uncertain Stephen Naismith's job is at Hearts. You know, some of the Hearts fans are all for him, some are against him, given his lack of experience. It's a big club. They demand success in so much as they want to be third. They want to be the third force. They want to be the best of the rest. And it's a huge job for someone with so much inexperience.
And of course, Aberdeen are also in 12 points. If you're a Motherwell fan, Andy, though, are you thinking that's a bit of a red flag that Stuart is putting himself...
I've interviewed him over the last number of weeks in a couple of games I've been at Motherwell. I think what you get from Stuart is a is a refreshing degree of honesty. So he's obviously been asked a question today. I don't think
that's
he's
true.
Come out and,
of course.
And made a statement. Yeah. And he obviously feels really strongly about it. There is a lot of it that I can see, but having been around football for so long, it's absolutely brutal. Sometimes the time that you get in coaching and management, and what a change can happen in the space of a few weeks.
You're right. He was asked the question. And Derek McInnes was asked the same question yesterday. Because I'm just looking at the table. Livy in the bottom with 10, along with Ross County. OK, Ross County have made the change. David Martindale must be the longest serving manager in the league. St Johnstone on 11, they've just made the change. Aberdeen, 12 points, along with Motherwell. And then Hibs on 15, they made the change, as you mentioned. Lee Johnson, just a couple of months ago. It seems ages ago, doesn't it? That was September. And then Kilmarnock on 16. So Dundee on 17, along with Hearts. There's not an awful lot in it. So Derek McInnes was saying a similar thing about the turnover in managers. And he said a few years ago, that was the pattern in England. I thought we were a bit better than that in Scotland. Two inexperienced managers, this is him saying, and Michael and Stephen, have lost their jobs. And two experienced guys, Malky and Lee Johnson, have gone as well. Derek said, circumstances are different for everyone. But as a stat, we aren't even out of November. And a third of the clubs have changed their manager. It's poor and disappointing. He also said, for me, Malky Mackay was Ross County's best player. You know, he was their best operator.
And they wouldn't be in the league without him. His management in that playoff. Now, I know that having finished second bottom, you're in a playoff, so it's not the most successful of seasons. But his changes in those two playoff games ensured that, you know, Ross County stayed up. If he was in charge of Partick Thistle, they would be in the top flight. But if you'd spoken to a lot of Hibs fans at the start of the season, I think they would have wanted a change. They weren't happy with even what he was saying post-match in some of the games that they had been to, and he was painting a different picture to a game that they had seen. If you speak to the majority, I think, Graham, of Rangers fans, I think they wanted a change. They did not believe in Michael Beale. And that's why it can be so tough.
Yep, I agree. Definitely the Rangers fans were calling for a change. Ross County, you look at that as well. What is success for Ross County? If they stay in the league, if they finish 10 for the next 5 years and stay in the league, that's success for a team like Ross County. So I don't know what they're expecting these managers to do. As Andy mentioned there, it's obviously disappointing that they're in the playoff position, but if it wasn't for the leadership and the quality of Malky Mackay had, they would probably ended up going down after that game.
And yet Roy McGregor cares, you know, for one thing, the future of that
does.
Club that he's put so much money into. And
he cares for the
area.
They had a great relationship. And I think he did appreciate the amount of work that Malky Mackay was doing, you know, away from the ground in terms of supporter liaison and getting out into the community and making the club a big part of the community. And I think the top flight of Scottish football, it's great that it's represented by a club in the Highlands. It used to be both Ross County and Inverness, but I always found it a pleasure to go up there and cover games.
We don't want to be radio guillotine here where you're looking to see who's next, but it's the inevitability. It's a results business. And no matter, I mean, nobody got more praise than Stuart Kettlewell for months. Quite rightly. It was remarkable. But you know, there does come a point, and any neutral would be hoping that Motherwell move up the table. In fact, I think you're not looking at anyone thinking, oh, I hope they go down. It's not the case. At Livingston, David Martindale spoke about it before anyone else did when they were further up the league. There's a new majority shareholder, I think, in town. And he said, yeah, I'm here. If I'm not right for it, you know, just speak to me. And yet he's steeped in that football club, isn't he? You were there for a short time.
Yeah, I came through there. So I look out for him a little bit as well. So they've always been a club that's, as I mentioned there, if they survive in the Premier League, then that is success for them. Probably since they've been promoted, they've been favourites to go back down. They've got the lowest budget in the league. So I think he got them into the top six, I think, a few years ago. And that was a real plus point for Livingston. So as I say there, if they stay up, that's their goal at the start of the season. So that is success for them.
We always talk about Celtic, Rangers, their finances, the amount of money that they spend on players, the amount of money that players' wages are. Everyone else, you know, in the bottom six, the resources are so modest. And that's why you see a lot of players doing the rounds at St Johnstone, Ross County, Kilmarnock, You know, they tend to they tend to move around the, if you like, the bottom six teams, and they are all so successful, as Graham says, if they finish 10th or above, there's, you know, there's no panic.
Is it too early to say who's going to go down automatically? I mean, a month ago, it was St Johnstone who looked as though they were...
Well, you say at the start of every season, you have a guess.
Yeah.
And, you, well, I tend to base it on players. Mm-hmm. What have they got? Have they got a bit of pace? Have they got a bit of quality? Have they got a goal scorer? Have they got reliable defenders? Mm-hmm. Have they got a good goalkeeper? You tend to, you know, throw all these balls mm-hmm. into the air. And listen, I said St Johnstone would go down. Yeah. Sorry, St Mirren. We go down there last season.
What do you know?
And exactly, what do you, I mean, what a job that Stuart Robertson is, Stephen Robinson has done there to take St Mirren so comfortably into the top six.
You could have manoeuvred that and said St Johnstone. I bet somebody would have been honest.
I said they
sure.
were the bottom two, St Mirren, St Johnstone, so there you go.
Very, the honest man. And he did play at Ayr United for a while, of course, the honest men. Graham, who do you think? What's your feeling just now?
Well, if you look at it at the minute, obviously Motherwell are in a real bad place. I think they will have enough to get out of it after their game at the weekend. They've got a nice run of fixtures coming up that will be looking to get points from. But I believe now, with the change that's just been made, I think Ross County could be in trouble. I think, as I said, the Livingston will always be down and around there. But I think Ross County could go this season.
Wow. And I got it wrong again. I thought Dundee would go down before a ball was kicked. Yeah. I thought the step up would be too great, but... underestimated just how good, how impressive that they would become. And in Tony Docherty, they've got a guy who's got tremendous experience.
The Go Radio Football Show with Global Eco Energy. Free quotes for solar PV, battery storage and heat pumps. Let's go!
Heading towards the weekend, we'll talk championship and the full card shortly. For the weekend, we'll look at the returning championship and who's going to come up from there. Obviously Dundee United have got off to a flyer, disappointment in the Trophy Cup last week. What's coming up this weekend, we'll tell you soon. And looking forward to the games in the Premiership. Celtic Motherwell is the biggest of the games on Saturday. There'll be, what, around 60,000 there for getting back to Celtic, of course. Andy, it's that game in hand, but means Celtic are in a really good position as they go into this game, because they could go even further ahead of the Rangers game on Sunday.
Yeah, is that 11 points before Rangers play? Yeah. Rangers would obviously have the two games in hand, but you always prefer the points in the bag. Celtic will be huge favourites against Motherwell. I mean, Motherwell are really struggling, and I do think it's the next few games after the Celtic one when Motherwell play the likes of Ross County, maybe St Johnstone. They're the ones they need to pick up points from. And very quickly, if you can get a couple of wins on the bounce, it can give you a bit of breathing space.
Brendan Rodgers has been speaking about his team, the level of performance since he arrived.
It's always going to be a challenge. It doesn't come into, you don't come into any season here at Celtic and it gets easier. You know, the Champions League is the very highest level of European football, and what you find at that level is the attacking players, the forward players, as good as you'll come across. So that's always a challenge. I think if I look domestically, we clearly should have had 13 out of 13 wins. You know, the two games that we've drawn, we could have won, but we didn't. But we learned from them. And I think from a Champions League perspective, I think there's a narrative around, I just sense a little bit around the overall start. But I think the players have been fantastic. In the Champions League, if you take away that second half against Atletico Madrid, the players have been very, very good. The players have been excellent. They've been getting better each performance, you know, very coordinated. You see the spirit in the team. And in the Champions League and the other games, we've been really competitive, even with Feyenoord, with nine men. So I understand where we're at. It's a level where you need to have quality, of course, and experience. But experience also comes from gaining experience. But there's no doubt we want to be stronger going forward over the coming seasons here. That was one of the big drivers to come back.
And of course, Lazio next week and Feyenoord a couple of weeks later. Still time, or is that just being optimistic? But there is time. Celtic could do it in Rome.
Could do. I think it's unlikely. Their away form is so poor. It would be great to think there was something riding on the last game at home in Glasgow. Unbelievable crowd. The fact that if Celtic win that, you know, something could happen. That would be terrific, but I can't see it. Celtic have been outclassed in this group.
Tuesday the game is, Graham, what do you think? Could you see Celtic getting a point or maybe a win?
So they certainly could. They've certainly got the talent and the ability to go and do it. But in terms of the previous results in the Champions League, I don't think they've won a game for the last six seasons. So I think it's going to be very, very difficult if they're to go and win the next two games. It's a really tough place to go on Tuesday night. But like I said, who's to say that they can't go there and get a result and take it into the last game?
He was asked about the plan for the squad.
No, we always know what we want. I think the plan, when we sat down in the summer, we understood where we were at, and of course some players then move on that you maybe don't expect to. We're also aware of the Asian Cup, so nothing surprises us. We know where we're at. It's just now about the availability, and for me it's now about getting players in that are going to improve us and be better than what we have, and that's something now. It's important we've got a lot of young players that are there to develop and grow. But you also need players for the present, and that's what we look at.
Andy, no more project players for the moment. He needs those that are ready to play.
I think the supporters will be glad to hear it, potentially excited. As a more or less a more difficult window in January, but you would expect Celtic to strengthen. Celtic want to ensure that they get this title, given the state of the Champions League and the riches that they bring for next season. And I still maintain right now Celtic have got a much stronger squad. They have been pushed a little bit by some of the injuries they've picked up, but in my view they're still a better squad than Rangers have.
Graham, would you agree?
No, I wouldn't necessarily agree. I think if Rangers played to the way they've played the last since the new manager's come in, I think it would be closer. Obviously Celtic are favourites there. If they win their game on Saturday before Rangers kick off, they're 11 points clear, so they're certainly favourites. But I think there's three Old Firm games to play, so there's plenty of time for Rangers to claw back the points. They're certainly capable of doing it.
And that'll be the test, the biggest test, the lot's for the new manager, because I keep thinking back to just over a year ago and Michael Beale got off to a really good start. Remember, it was win after
it
win.
It will be. We touched on it earlier. This period now, up until the break, will be the big test, and I genuinely think that Sunday will be the marker for it. I think if Rangers go and set a marker and win the game comfortably, it gives them a platform to go and build on in these games that are coming up, because we spoke earlier about these big games are coming up. We've got this Sunday, we've got the European games, we've got the Cup final, and then obviously the Old Firm games, which will take care of itself when it comes about. So I do believe that Sunday, if you don't go and win the game, then you can forget about the league. So I think that's the first one you need to concentrate on.
Wow. It's a huge period for Rangers, and if they win at Aberdeen at the weekend and then go on and win the Cup, that could be quite a springboard for them, Andy. But as you hear from Graham, ex-Rangers player saying, but if they don't win this weekend, the league's probably, it's not going to happen.
If Aberdeen were to win this weekend, they would have every confidence winning the League Cup final as well. But Rangers, about Celtic, in my view, having a better squad than Rangers, more quality. I think Rangers have got more quality than Aberdeen. I'm really looking forward to the game on Sunday. I think it's been sold beautifully, but you're right, the Cup final will tell you a lot. And of course, the game against Celtic at Parkhead at the end of the month.
Let's go on the lines. Laurie has called in, big Celtic fan in the east end of this great city. Hi, Laurie.
Hey, panel, good evening.
Hi, Laurie.
Good evening. Hi, how are you doing?
I'm doing pretty good, guys, and good. I hope you are too. I've got 2 points to make tonight. The first one is, I hope that the problems that have existed between the Green Brigade and the Board of Directors can be resolved amicably. I personally think that the Green Brigade are the beating heart of the Celtic support. When they are not there, the atmosphere within the ground is almost funereal. It's like a cemetery with lights, in my opinion. But now there, it's a kaleidoscopic profusion of colour. The sounds and the noises and the songs reverberate around the stadium. They generate a very positive atmosphere. In addition to that, they have been very supportive of impoverished people here at home. And of disenfranchised people abroad. So to every one of the Green Brigade, the young men and women, I salute them for their support. They make such a huge difference to us. That's my first point. My second point is regarding the team. I was very pleased to hear Brendan's comments here moments ago about how essentially how the team needs improving. I know that during the summer transfer window, I was on the programme and I was very positive about the young signings that were made because it augurs well for the future. But I think we've reached the point now, something has changed, and that is that Philip Clement has proven that he's to be taken seriously. Rangers now are a much more credible side than what they were when his predecessor, Michael Beale, was in charge. Rangers, I think, posted profits of £250,000 net, unless I'm mistaken. Celtic, financially, have got huge advantages.
Yeah.
We are some £40 million in profit, I think. Yes. And I think it would be almost criminal if come January, Peter Lawwell and the board failed to support Brendan Rodgers. If Rangers were to win the league, I don't think they will. I think that the present squad we have will stave off any challenge from Rangers. But unless Brendan was given a financial backing and we came unstuck, I think that that would be almost unforgivable for many Celtic supporters, myself included. The panel starts.
Andy, first of all, on that
yes,
one.
I agree with Laurie. It would be unforgivable, but I would be utterly amazed if Celtic didn't strengthen in this January window. Whether it's a signing of a few million pounds or whether it's a loan player. I mean, you've listened to Brendan Rodgers. He wants quality. He doesn't want any more development players. He's got enough of them.
And they need a striker during the Asian Cup.
And they need I would imagine they would get a forward-thinking player. But I think they would get someone else as well. I think they will show their financial muscle. And that will ensure that they have what it takes to meet any sort of challenge that Rangers might come up with. It's Rangers' transfer window as well. I don't know how much they've got to spend, but Celtic have got more to spend. But it's quality. You want a bit of quality, and given that Brendan Rodgers is very familiar with the players down south, I would be amazed if he doesn't bring in a couple of quality players.
And Hatate came in around this time, didn't he?
Mm.
Yeah, January window. So everyone says, oh, it's a tough one, but they're, you know, out
I'll
the
ask
road.
The question, yeah. Paul, sure. Andy and the college, is it Brian, sorry?
It's Laurie.
Laurie, sorry.
It's the legend, Laurie.
Yeah. if you believe that Celtic have got a strong enough squad to go and win the league this season, would you not rather wait until the summer and strengthen? If you believe now they've got enough to go and win the league, why don't you wait till the summer? Then you can try and get a better quality player in to go and have a go at the Champions League. If you think you're bringing a player in now to go and win the league, if you're confident enough, you've got the squad to go and win the league, you don't need to spend the money in January.
I think Celtic have got the squad to win the league, but I think there's a window here.
Do you think they'll get a player in this window that will improve them for the Champions League next season?
I would be. It's not about improving Celtic for the Champions League. I think Celtic's philosophy is to be above Rangers, to win the league, to get access to the Champions League again. So I'd be amazed if Celtic didn't bring in at least a couple of players that the supporters will be excited by in this January window.
Laurie, what would you say to the question?
Well, what I would say to Graham is that I think perhaps he underestimates the challenge presented by his previous team, Rangers. I don't. I think it's a live challenge. I think it's a serious challenge. Yes, I do think that the present squad has sufficient ability and qualities to see off Rangers. But I think it would be very tight if we went and bought a few players in January, even loan signings. And the thing, of course, is that the Asian Cup is looming. And that will force the departure of the likes of Hatate if he's fit. Kyogo and all of the Asian players, I think there's maybe five or six. Now, there's no doubt in my mind that they would represent, a blow. I think that the most pressing need, in my estimation, is to sign a forward. Even a loan signing.
Yeah.
We've got six and a half there. Surplus to requirement. Yeah. I mean, you've got Scales, you've got Carter Vickers, you've got the two European signings.
Dabrowski
and Lager Bielka.
Yeah.
Stephen Welsh and Nat Phillips. why do we need six centre-backs?
Yeah.
That's surplus a requirement.
Do you need a cover left-back? Do you need someone else there, do you think?
Yes, indeed. Yeah. We need somebody to challenge Greg Taylor. It seems to be that of recent times, a lot of teams have been targeting Greg Taylor in that left-back position, particularly in Europe. So we can't afford to rest on our laurels. We've got to move with the times. I do believe that money will be made available, funds will be made available to Brendan. I think we'll win, but not for a second to underestimate the challenge that Rangers present. Under his Clement's predecessor, he contested six games with Celtic. He won only one, and that was a relatively meaningless fixture. If you can call any old firm a meaningless fixture, the game after we'd clinched the league. The other five games, Celtic won four, and one was drawn. So this guy, Clement, has got a good pedigree. He's got a gravitas that Michael Beale lacked. We can't afford to be complacent or take anything for granted. That's my point of view, guys.
Okay, yep.
I think Laurie speaks a lot of sense. He probably echoes what a lot of Celtic supporters are thinking. Get another striker in, someone maybe whose name they recognise, someone who can excite them, maybe a bit of cover for Greg Taylor at left back. I don't know. There's been so much talk about maybe getting another keeper in. Mm-hmm. But
do you agree to get another keeper?
I don't think it's essential.
No?
I really don't think it's essential at all.
Who's the backup to Joe Hart for the rest of the season? Well, certainly for next season, let's say.
Yeah, maybe for next season, but I just don't see it as essential at the moment. I know that some supporters do, but there you go. I would just be amazed in general if Celtic don't strengthen in this coming window. Whether Rangers improve or not, whether Celtic are further in front than they are at the moment, or whether it's neck and neck.
Yeah, I agree. He's made a lot of very good points there. I do think Rangers will be closer and they will challenge. And I was going to say, if Celtic did go further ahead, does it change who you want to bring in? I'm not sure. But Celtic will certainly look to strengthen. As I mentioned there, they've got players that they're going to lose to the Asian Cup. I think Rangers are going to strengthen as well. So it will be an interesting January.
And your first point, Laurie, about the Green Brigade. And Andy, we have said about all the good things they bring. They have to sort this out about some of the things going on away from home.
I don't know how far down the road it is. Yeah. I don't know if there is constant dialogue. I mean, it would seem to me that I don't know anyone in the Green Brigade. Mm. They do seem a younger bunch and fair enough to them. I would disagree with Laurie on that. I think Celtic Park has always got a heartbeat, whether the Green Brigade are there or not. And I can imagine if there's no Green Brigade members at the Rangers game at the end of December, I mean, Celtic Park will be bouncing. My only regret is that there's going to be no away fans, but that's going to be a constant, you would imagine, for some time.
Laurie, thanks so much for the call.
The Go Radio Football Show with Global Eco Energy. Free quotes for solar PV, battery storage and heat pumps.
Let's go! Paul Cooney here with Andy Walker and Graham Dorrans. I had an orange, a tangerine, just before I started. I said, guys, did you still have this? Graham, you're still playing. What do you have at half-time? Because you used to say you can have orange. What do you have it?
Yeah, I've seen people have all sorts. I played with Ben Foster. He used to have a chocolate bar, a Snickers or a Dairy Milk at half-time.
What? Seriously?
Yeah. There's Jaffa Cakes, Jelly Babies.
Size was it? Was it the...
it was just extra large Dairy Milk, I think it was.
We never had anything. It was just a drink, a tea, a coffee or a water, a juice. Yeah. There was never anything to eat.
Half time, a coffee?
Well, I never took a coffee, but it was always there. Tea, coffee, water, juice. Mm. But maybe I'm getting back to
pre-match rituals. Have you still got things that you have to do? Whether you were playing at Rangers or West Brom, Norwich or Johnston Borough, what's your ritual on a Saturday?
I've not got any that I really stick to, unless I play well and if I score, then I try and do what I've done the previous week, but not often did it work.
Any goals this season? I don't know.
Yeah, a couple. Yeah, I've scored a couple. I got a penalty last week in the last minute. I've only been playing the last 15-20 minutes of games, as the legs only take me where they used to, so I'm only getting 15-20.
Are you targeted? Do you feel targeted by some players that they're out to?
Yes, I think to start with, I was a little bit. There was a friendly game at the start of the season where I maybe lost my head a little bit. Where there was a video, I gave a little bit back out. It maybe went over the top. So I've not really had anything since that. So maybe it worked.
We need to see that video.
A few minutes ago, I said, "We'll look at the championship at the weekend." Yeah, we'll look at the table, not at the fixtures.
Because it's the Scottish Cup.
Yeah, that you kept me right, and so did Graham. Of course, the Scottish Cup this weekend, which I was reading about this morning. So they were talking to Jim McIntyre, of course, who had success with Kelly and his record at Dunfermline, because that's the big game tomorrow night in the Cup. Starts Friday night. So looking forward to...
Big game for Pollock. They play Brora Rangers.
Right, yeah.
So that's my upset. Pollock will win that.
At Newlands Field?
No. Away from
home. It's away from home, beg your pardon. I was looking at Dunfermline Raith Rovers tomorrow night, 7:45. Who's going to win that one, Graham?
I think Dunfermline will win that. I've watched them the last couple of weeks. I still
affection.
From pulling there. I still know James McPayton, still keep in touch with him as well. So I think they'll win that. They've been doing well recently. They've got themselves in a playoff position, and I think they'll make the playoffs this year as well.
Andy, who do you expect to win tomorrow night? And that one, Dunfermline against Raith Rovers.
I'm going to go for Raith. I think, having spoken to a few people who watch the championship, I think they've been impressed with the results that Raith have had. They're the closest challengers, albeit Dundee United are comfortable there, but they should be winning the playoffs for this season.
May seems a long way away, doesn't it, Andy?
Yeah.
But you've got your Scottish Cup medal as well.
Yes. Yeah. One of the great days. Glorious. It was a hot sunny day. Beat United 2-1. Two goals from my good friend McAvaney. Happy days.
That's right. You came from behind, didn't you? It was late. Because that was that season where...
Kevin Gallagher,
of course. Yeah. Terrific player as well. Played in the UEFA Cup final, didn't he? So just looking for some of the other ones. And of course, the Glasgow Derby. Partick Thistle against Queen's Park.
Yeah.
Graham, who do you fancy in that one?
It's another one of my old clubs, so I'm going to have to go for Partick Thistle. Queen's Park had done terrific last season to get themselves challenging for the title, but I think they've not been as confident this season and as free flowing. And I think Thistle are doing well. Thistle are up the table as well, so I'll go for Partick Thistle win on that one.
Andy, what do you think? Also,
yeah, I think Thistle will do it. I'm not convinced they'll be as strong as they were last season, getting into the playoffs and actually the playoff final. They've lost a couple of players, but I think they're doing okay. I think they'll beat Queens in the Cup.
And Falkirk, who are on fire in League One, up against Formentine United. So Stephen McGinn, we'll find out tomorrow night, is he playing, is he back? And Hamilton also challenging. They're up against Kelty Hearts, Barry's old team from a few years ago. Morton, Leanne's always listening in. They're up against Bowness United. Loads of games this weekend. Airdrie are at Stranraer, and Dumbarton at Annan. And Albion Rovers, back in the big time, out the division now, but they're playing Bonnyrigg Rose.
You mentioned Bowness, played against them in a Junior Cup final.
Yeah, of course.
So there you go.
When you were playing for?
When I was playing with Bayliston, they beat us 2-0 at Ibrox. Okay. It was a great occasion.
Yeah, that's enough on that one. Thank you. Let's get back from there. From Bayliston, let's go to Pittodrie St Mirren Livy. Who's going to win this weekend? Graham Dorrans, who do you fancy here?
I think St Mirren will win that. It's a home tie. They've been very good at home. As I touched on earlier, I think Livingston will find it difficult this season. St Mirren have been very good. They're free flowing, scoring a lot of goals. So I think St Mirren should be comfortable. 3 points for them.
Ryan Strain only played for a short time for Australia the other evening. He'll be back. What do you think? Who's going to win this one, Andy?
St Mirren Livy.
Yeah.
I expect St Mirren to carry on their good work, and having seen them recently at home to Hibs where they got a late equaliser. I think they'll beat Livingston by a couple of goals.
Ross County against Kilmarnock, staying with you, Andy.
Yeah, I'll go for that. New manager bounce, and maybe Ross County will get it. Kilmarnock, as we all know, have got a dreadful away record. It's totally different when they're at Rugby Park. So I'll go for Ross County.
Good news, though. It's going to be the year after, all being well.
Great.
Grass pitch. And that must help the club. They've got to stay up. Mm-hmm.
I always remember in my early days trying to... make your way in football. Kilmarnock was one of the best surfaces in Scotland, and it would be great to see them get back to that.
Are they going to win at Ross County?
I don't think so. I'm going to follow Andy there as well. The new manager bounce. I think Ross County will win that game. I think Kilmarnock have struggled away from home, so I'm going to go for Ross County to win.
The Morrisons and Kilmarnock will be raging with both of you. Hearts against St Johnstone then. What do you reckon, Graham? Who's going to win this one?
I think this will be a tough game, you know. I think, obviously, with Craig Levine going back to Hearts, I think he'll be looking to go back and cause a little bit of an upset. Hearts, as we touched on earlier on, Stephen Naismith, under a little bit of pressure trying to get results. I'll go for a draw in this game.
Go for a draw. Stephen Naismith, he's got the Scotland striker, Lauren Shankland, firing.
Yeah, and he's got a better squad than St Johnstone. I know that Craig Levine has made an impact already there, but I'm going to go for a comfortable home win. Hearts to win it back. A couple of goals there.
Dundee against Hibs. We mentioned it earlier. What do you think?
Yeah, I just think from middle to front, I always like what Hibs have got. They've got Ewan, they've got Venta. They've got a number of goal scorers in their team. They've got Martin Boyle. Everyone fit. I expect an away win there.
Away win. What do you think? Who's going to be happier, Nick Montgomery or Tony Docherty?
Yeah, I think it's going to be a tough game for Hibs, as we touched on earlier on. Tony Docherty's got Dundee playing very well, but the Venti, Boyle and players like that, I think Hibs will just have enough to go up there and get 3 points.
Celtic against Motherwell. Just before we go there, we've been talking about who's coming in, who's going out. The manager spoke about what might happen in January, because he has said the squad is too big.
Listen, there's going to be naturally players that will want to go out and play. And players that want to move on, and then like I say, we have to see if there's if the players are better than what we have that are available to bring in. So I can't sit here now and give you a number and say what's going out and what's coming in, but there's always movement.
Of course, Mikey Johnson could be one of them. Man of the match for Ireland the other night. I know they didn't do well, but is he one of them? We're running out of time. Graham, what do you think is going to happen? Celtic against Motherwell.
There's only one outcome. I think Celtic will be comfortable. It's probably a free hit for Motherwell. We spoke earlier about the games coming up after this one. That'll be the one that Stuart Kettwell will be targeting. I think Celtic will win this comfortably by at least a couple of goals.
And you'll be looking for Kyogo to be back after the head knock the other week. Didn't travel with Japan.
Yeah, hopefully he's made a good recovery, a quick recovery, but Celtic should win this comfortably by a few goals.
Looking forward to the game. Should be...
Yeah.
Decent game.
Yeah, Celtic at home in their last outing against Aberdeen. I think they gave everyone what they were expecting. You know, it was comfortable even before you get into the injury time, and then Celtic put the icing on the cake with another few goals. So they are very capable of winning games like this by a decent margin.
And a little bit of insight from Matt O'Reilly about well-being. He's been speaking about it today.
I say a lot. Speak with my, I don't even know how to describe it, my friend / life coach who lives in India regularly, work a lot with him just in terms of speaking about things which were maybe, you know, kept inside me for a long time. I might not have had the, not necessarily the courage to speak about, but just the knowledge to understand how to like speak about it with somebody. So that's helped me loads. That's allowed me to be probably a more well-rounded person as well, I'd say. So I feel more confident and open to speak to, you know, people in general as a result of that. So just all of that as a collective has kind of just helped me stay consistently in a good frame of mind.
Isn't that healthy to get that in-depth insight from Matt O'Reilly? So, yeah, it's changing, isn't it? People, men open up now more than they did before.
I was just about to say that it is changing. People are coming out, they're speaking more. So it's nice to hear that. He's got a friend/coach that he spoke about there that he's away speaking to. And that coincides with getting out in the pitch and playing well and getting in the right frame of mind and getting the head right and getting the confidence and that. You can see that in his performances. It's all coming together for him.
On Sunday then, after your game, you'll be watching Aberdeen against Rangers. What are you going to see?
Yep, it's going to be a tough game. But I would fancy Rangers to come out on top. I think they'll win by the odd goal. We'll go for 2-1 Rangers.
Andy?
Yeah, I think we'll see a cracker. I think you'll see a lot of goals, but I do expect Rangers to win, so I'll go for a 3-2 Rangers.
Why I enjoy Newcastle.
I will.
On Saturday on the tune. Against Chelsea. The tune. Thanks, Graham.
Thank you. Great
to have you on the programme. Hopefully
thanks,
you'll come back soon. Cheers, Andy. Thank you so much. It's Barry tomorrow night, along with Stephen McGinn at 5.
The Go Radio Football Show with Global Eco Energy. Reduce your energy bills with the latest renewable energy products. Let's go!
Global Eco Energy sell and install renewable energy products to domestic, commercial, and public sector customers. with access to a wide range of renewable energy products, including solar PV, battery storage, air source heat pumps, and eco-garden makeovers, we offer a bespoke service tailored to your exact needs. For a free quote and to find out more about grants and funding options, go to global-eco.co.uk.